wife sinking sand, but I can't even walk without you holding my hand. I can't even walk without you holding my hand.
Yeah. Let's pray. Lord our God and Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. Thank you for your blessings, your watch care over us. Thank you for this pastor who has seen your guidance to come here and stay here and preach your word. And I thank you for sending him to be your messenger. I ask you to bless him, bless his message today. And I pray, Lord, for each person that's here and listening, I pray that you'll touch their hearts and their minds, and that they will make decisions for you. If there's some here that do not know you as Lord and Savior, I pray that they won't leave here today in that same condition. Bless us now with your presence. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. If you'll join me in God's wonderful word today in the Gospel of John, chapter 10, I'd like to talk about bragging a little bit today. Bragging. We all like to brag. If y'all didn't know, I've got a granddaughter that hit a home run this past week. We like to brag. My grandkids, they'll eat, and it's hard to get our grandkids to eat, and they'll if they ever finish their plate, they like to come in there and show them their clean plate. I cleaned my plate. Like to brag about it. That's not something I have to brag about. I do it every time, okay? I clean my plate. We like to brag. This morning, I'd like to brag about Jesus. I want to brag about Jesus. You know, we talk about a lot of things when we come to church, but we need to be doing a lot of bragging. We need to be bragging about Jesus. When people talk about our church, they talk about different things about us, we'll be bragging about Jesus. When people ask about what do y'all believe in, we like to brag about Jesus. That's what we need to talk about. We don't need to talk about how long the preacher preached today. We don't talk about how the song service might have been a little off key, or the temperature might have been a little off. We just need to be bragging about Jesus. In fact, in verse 14, it says, Jesus is saying this, and he says, I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep, and I'm known of mine. In other words, I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. They know me. Do we really know him today? Well, I want to kind of refresh our memories a little bit about who Jesus is. I want to brag about Jesus a little bit today. And to the point it may re-energize our minds, to the point that maybe we just want to go and brag a little bit ourselves. I mean, when we start bragging, we kind of got that look on our face that we've been with Jesus. Like Moses, when he come down from the mountain, he'd been with Jesus, and they could tell he'd been with the Lord. We won't be able to brag about Jesus. You ever seen a brand new dad? I've seen them up here at the Women's Children's Hospital when they got a brand new baby. They can step on an elevator and hadn't seen you in their entire life. Don't know you from Adam. Normally, they wouldn't give you the time of day. Don't even make eye contact. But they're waiting for somebody to look at them. And as soon as they give them eye contact, they say, look, I'm a new dad. You don't see pictures? They might even give you a gift right there. Right there, just let me tell you about my baby. I can tell you about their baby before they open their mouth. Best looking baby up there. Isn't it? I mean, they like to brag. I want to be able to brag about Jesus. In fact, you hear this Psalms 23 a lot, especially at funerals. But I want to kind of bring it up today. Because I think even at funerals, a lot of times people are bent trying to be comforted, and that's what we're there to do. But I think the Lord is more than just a funeral. I think he's much more than that. In fact, Psalm 23 says, the Lord is my shepherd. What does that mean? He watches after me. He looks over me. He takes care of me. He's my shepherd. My shepherd. When my grandkids were younger, they used to, I had to admit, I wasn't the favorite. I still not. Nana is the favorite, okay, at our house. And they'd get over there wanting Nana to hold them and all this kind of stuff, and they'd kind of get distracted. And I'd get over there, and I'd sit next to Nana or get in Nana's lap, and I'd say, "This is my Nana, my Nana." And they'd always push me, "No, that's not your Nana, that's my Nana." They don't like to share their Nana. That's their Nana. Well, the Lord, He is my shepherd. And being my shepherd, He said, "I shall not want." You know what? He knows me better than anybody else. He knows me better than I know myself. He knows what's best for me. And He knows how to take care of me. He knows me because He is my shepherd. And because He's my shepherd, I don't have to want for anything. If I need it, He's there. He's there. I mean, He takes care of us. Now, you take a brand new baby. When that baby begins to get fussy, it gets everybody's attention, doesn't it? Everybody in the whole house wants to do something. They want to give it a pacifier. They want to pet it. They want, "Well, let me have that baby." You know, everybody wants to take care of that baby. But most of the time, that baby knows who it belongs to. When that mama gets it, you know, it really gets comforted. Well, my shepherd knows me, and He takes care of me. He provides anything that I want, He takes care of. We're kind of the same way as a baby today. We go to crying, and He shows up, doesn't He? You know, you take those babies and you put them, you know, they kind of graduate them off to their own room, but, you know, then they still got to have a monitor over there to hear them and just whimper a little bit. Or a lot of these mamas, they don't have to hear a whimper. "I ain't heard them in a while. I better go make sure they're still breathing," you know. I never had to wonder if mine was still breathing. They was crying all the time. I knew they was still alive. But the Lord is our shepherd. He's watching over it all the time. And I'm proud to say that He's my shepherd. He said also in the psalmist, He said, He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. In other words, He provides for me. He is my provider. He's the one that takes care of me. And He provides me out of a provision that's unlimited. He can give me anything that He wants to give. When I was a small child, my mom and dad ran a convenience store. Now, I don't know what your mom and dad did, but your parents own a convenience store, you hit the jackpot. There's always candy in the store, okay? Sheree, you've been there. There's candy in the store. You might have been one of those households, "We ain't got nothing sweet to eat." If you had a parent that had a convenience store, there's always something sweet to eat, okay? There's always a Coke in the house, all right? The Lord knows how to provide for us. He is our shepherd. He is our provider. It said not only as our God and bragging about how He provides for us, giving us that green pasture, "He leadeth me beside the still water." He is our guide. In a land where we're a foreign people here in this land, but He is our guide through it all. Now, most of you know that I'm just an old Alabama boy. In fact, I never did get... Huntsville was a big town for me to come to. For me to be able to go off into another place, one time we went off to Dallas, Texas. I'm bragging a little bit. I went to Dallas, Texas. I was scared to death. Scared to death. But I had a friend there, and my friend that I went to go see, I had to go do a renewing their vows, I think, of 10 years. I can't remember what it was. They were renewing their vows, and I was going out there to preach that ceremony. So they asked me to come out and do that ceremony, and you know what he did out there? He drove a bus all over Dallas to do tours and different things. So he knew everything about Dallas. He knew where all the roads were, where Kennedy was shot. He knew all those kind of things that took place. And it was pretty neat. Because when I got to Dallas, I didn't have to drive. When you get off those little old roads up in Morgan City and you get to Dallas, you don't need to be driving in Dallas. I got on that bus. He got on the. He drove the bus. I got on the bus, and he just drove. He said, "Oh, right here's where this happened. Oh, this here's such and such street." You know, I had. I just sat back and I just enjoyed the tour. If I'd have been driving, Debbie said, "This is where." I said, "Hush! I'm just trying to figure out where to go next. I turn left. I turn right. I'm looking at the map. Well, what does the sign say?" I mean, I'd be panicking the whole time. Panicking. People blowing the horn. What are you doing on a one-way street going the wrong way? I'd be all kind of problems be going on. But it's a whole lot different when you got a guide leading you around. You can kind of relax. Because you know, they know where you're at. I'd be the whole time wondering if I've been to the right place. Here today, I can brag. God can assure me today I'm where I belong. I'm not in the wrong place. I'm not going in the wrong direction. I'm where I'm supposed to be. That's what I've got. I've got a guide today. I can brag that I've got a guide better than anybody else in the world. He knows exactly where everything's at. He knows exactly what's fixing to occur. Oh, I can brag about the guide that I do have because he leads me. He says he restoreth my soul. Not only does he provide and guide, he gives me hope when I had no hope. Have you ever been in life where you thought, I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't think there's anything that can be done. He gives me hope. That means something that can, in other words, I have a chance. I have a chance. There's a lot of things in life that I would think I don't have a chance at. I mean, you think one of the greatest, Michael Jordan, basketball players, you think I got a chance of beating him? I don't have a chance. You think I got a chance of dunking a regulation ball goal? I don't have a chance. Now, when I was younger, I reach up and touch the rim a little bit. Then I finally got to where I couldn't touch the bottom of the net. Now I can't get my feet off the floor anymore. I don't have a chance anymore. But with Jesus, there's always a chance. It doesn't matter what a doctor tells you. With Jesus, you still got a chance. He gives us hope. I don't care what's going on in your life. With Jesus in your life, you've always got hope. You've always got hope. I mean, I'll be honest. I've known some people that the doctors come in and it reassured them that they were not going to make it. They didn't realize they had Jesus because they still had hope. Oh, he does give us hope. It says not only does he restore our soul, in other words, he gives us a reason. We give us hope. He said he leads us in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. It says also he helps my life to have value. We may, in this old world, the old devil can convince us that we really don't have value, that we're good for nothing. In fact, with the sin that comes into our lives, and we really do not have a lot of value. But with Jesus, we have value. We all want to have value. We all want to feel important. We all want to know that we have value. But I promise you, he gives me value. I come across a person that they feel, lower than a snake's belly, and they think that the life's not worth living. They just don't have Jesus, that shepherd, because he gives them value. Value is something that doesn't need to be thrown away, something that needs to be cherished. And my life has value. I know as we get older, we may think, man, I can't do this, I can't do that, I can't do all those other kind of things. I'm good for nothing. But then you realize Jesus gives you value when you can do nothing else. Some people may ask, why do they still live in this old world? I can't work anymore. I can't drive a car anymore. I can't do anything anymore. You have value with the Lord. That's why you're here. You have value. Because when things at my house doesn't have value, we throw it away. We throw it away. I mean, I tell you what, I love to see, when I open that freezer, I love to see there's a vanilla ice cream sitting in there, okay? I'm thinking, ooh, that's good stuff, okay? Good stuff. And I see that sitting in there, and all of a sudden I reach down and grab it, and I look inside of it, and the vanilla's gone. That carton has no value anymore. It has no value. You know what I do with that carton? I don't put it back in the freezer because it has no value. There's no need in me putting it in there to keep it good and cold and ready. I put it in the garbage. It has no value. Folks, without Jesus, I have no value. But all of a sudden, when I put Jesus on the inside, people look at me and think, ooh, he looks good, don't he? Because he's got value on the inside. Oh, I love my Savior because he gives me value. He said, verse 4 of Psalms, he said, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. You know what? He is my protector. Oh, I can get in some situations where I'm afraid. But that's a childish thing. There's nothing to be afraid of. I'll be honest, I used to be afraid of the dark. Now, I'm not afraid of the dark. The Lord's with me in the dark. I could be afraid around people sometimes. But the Lord's with you. You want somebody to go with you a lot of times. I've told you this story before, but I'll tell you it again. Maybe one person hadn't heard this. But I remember one time that we went over to our grandparents' house and visiting for a little while, me and my brother. And we stayed longer than we should have stayed, and it got dark. And I'll be honest with you. I called my mom to come get us because it was dark. We normally walk back and forth, but it was dark. We lived about 120 miles away. Seemed like it. Said, come get us, Mama. We're ready to come home. She said, you walked up there, you can walk back. I said, but Mama, it's dark. It's dark. She said, well, you can come on home. I was really worried about my brother. He's younger than me. Hung up the phone because I tell you, I was afraid of the dark, but I was afraid of Mama more than I was the dark, so I was going to go walk home. So I said, Brother, I said, you better hold my hand. I'll take care of you. I really wasn't worried about Brother, but I felt better if I had somebody's hand. And we began to walk. As we began to walk, we started walking faster out there in that dark. I mean, I ate a lot of stuff out there in that dark. But I was hanging on to my brother real tight. Till we're all of a sudden we were walking a little faster. Next thing you know, we were running. We were running in the dark. And I was holding my brother's hand to protect him, and all of a sudden my shoe came off. And scared as I was of the dark, I was scared to go home with one shoe. So I had to turn loose of my brother to go back after that shoe. You know, my brother didn't wait on me. He kept going. I was a bad feeling out there in that dark looking for that shoe. Nobody but me. Nobody but me. I was afraid. That's sort of the way we are in the world sometimes. We're afraid, thinking there's nobody else. People kind of get down on themselves, they ain't nobody else. But I can brag today, but I got Jesus today. I'm not by myself. As long as Jesus is with me, I'm not afraid anymore. What is there to be afraid of when Jesus is there? He is my shepherd. He says, if any animals are going to come out after me, he's there to get them. If the booger bear's out there, he's there to get him, right? There's nothing for me to be afraid of. He is my protector. He says also in verse 4, he says, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. He'll never leave me, and he always keeps me comforted. In other words, sometimes he needs to hold on to me. Sometimes we need to be a little pat on the back. That's who Jesus is. Let me brag on him. He's always there when we need it. When we need to be encouraged a little bit, he's always there. He knows how to send people our way. He knows how to send things to us. He knows how not only to protect us, he never leaves us, and he always comforts us. He said, thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. What does he do? He works in our life. He's there with us. And he goes on to say, he anointeth my head with oil, my cup runneth over. He said, he anointeth my head with oil. And I was reading this past week about how a shepherd would take his sheep, and he would take, and when he says anointed his head with oil, he put oil on his head for several different reasons. He anointed that sheep's head, number one, so they would oil it down, because those sheep were bad to get their heads in the thorns and the thickets and get tangled up. And there they'd be caught in the briars and the thorns and the thistles, and they'd be trapped. They couldn't get out. But he'd oil it up to where they can slide that old head in, slide the old head out of that thing, and he'd anoint it with oil. Not only that oil was to protect them from the thorn, but that ointment was to protect them from the flies that would get around their eyes and lay eggs around their eyes and stuff. That was an ointment for their eyes. Now, I don't know how you are about flies. I can't stand them. They of the devil, I'm here to tell you. Pesty little old things. I try to take me a nap on a Sunday afternoon, somebody opens the door and lets a fly in, and you know what? He's going straight to me, okay? Buzzing around. I'm so afraid he's going to go in my nose or my ears or something. That old pesty fly. Well, those ointments would help keep those flies away and the insects that would come and bother. So the Lord, not only that, He doctors us up. He gives us the thing to protect us from those things that can be pests. Now listen to me. Now some of y'all may done trying to doze on off into the Sunday afternoon now. Don't go just yet. Don't go just yet. Those pesty little old flies, they really can't hurt you, but they can bug you to death, can't they? Folks, in life, there's a lot of people that can just bug you to death. But I want you to understand, they can't hurt you. They can't bother you. Somebody can tell me I'm ugly. Somebody can tell me I'm fat. All that might be true, but that's still not going to hurt me. So why should I let anything anybody say bug me? Because God anoints me. And when we get God's anointing upon us, they can say those things and say, that just blows right off. I'm like a duck's back. You know, it just rolls right off. We should be able to let those things roll right off, because we've got a shepherd that takes care of us. The only time that things should bother us is when we get away from the shepherd, and the shepherd's not anointing us with his word and with his presence to the point that just doesn't bother us. Doesn't bother us. I've told this before, too. I remember when I got old enough that my mom and dad let me play football. Man, that was the glory days. I can feel it these days, but it was the glory days back then. I remember my first helmet they gave. Got my helmet. I took it home. I put it on. I was so proud to be able to wear that football helmet. Honest truth. I went and got a baseball bat, gave it to my little brother. I said, hit me. I did. You didn't know your preacher was that dumb, did you? I said, well, hit me. And he just reared back and he just hit me right in the head. I said, I didn't feel a thing. Didn't feel a thing. You know, when God anoints us, I don't feel a thing. So how can you just keep a smile on your face? Because I got protection. They think they hurt me. I don't feel a thing because I've been anointed by my shepherd. Oh, we need the anointing. Oh, let's brag about all the things that he does for us. He does so many things. He protects us. He anoints us. We need anointing because we are helpless. He says also he gives us more than enough. He says, my cup just runs over. I've got more than enough. You get to thinking, how am I going to manage? How am I going to make it? What do you mean? I've got more than enough. More than enough. I like to know that my cup is full. My wife and I, we're totally different about the gasoline in the vehicle. I like to see that thing over on the elf, okay? I like to know that I've got gas. That light will come on in the car. I've never seen that in my truck. But in her car, I get in, I see that light come on. Bing! I go to worrying. I get a little nervous. I get to look for a gas station. She'll say, oh, we got another 10 miles. I think, what? We need gas. Oh, we got enough to make it. She may be right. But I like to make it on full. Not with that light blinking at me, okay? In life, you may be just trying to just get by and just have enough. But look, my God, he keeps the tank full. We need a full tank. Folks, we don't need just a little Sunday morning every now and then. We need a full tank. I want to get all he'll give me. Because as long as I got a full tank, I don't have to worry about it. I mean, you come up to the gas station, I pass it by, and I look down. I say, I don't need you. I'm full. Old devil, he tries to wave a little thing at us. Said, man, look how good this is and what good. I don't need you. I'm full. I don't need anything that the world has to offer because God is filling the tank. My cup's running over. Now, look, that's not even half. I'm so full, I'm giving a little bit to somebody else. Giving something to somebody else. Isn't it amazing when you go by and you see somebody maybe broke down, out of gas, something, oh, feel bad for them. If I got a little extra, I give you a little extra. Because I've got more than enough. Because I've got a shepherd that takes care of me. I have plenty. The psalmist finishes up by saying, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. All the days of my life. He is good and merciful. He's going to take care of me. He's merciful. In other words, I don't deserve it. He's going to give me more than I really deserve. He cares about me even though I don't deserve it. He shows mercy. He said, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. In other words, he finishes up by saying, I wouldn't trade my shepherd for anything. I don't want to trade my shepherd for anything. I want to brag and say there's no comparison that this world or the devil can offer me better than the shepherd that I have. The pasture's not greener anywhere else. Brag about the shepherd. Oh, a lot of people talk about this church. They'll talk about that preacher. They'll talk about that music. Look, I don't trade anything for my shepherd. He's greater than anything else. He said, I'm the good shepherd, and I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. Real quickly, in closing, let's look at a few verses in this 10th chapter. Verse 1 says, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that entered not by the door unto the sheepfold, but climbeth up some other way, the same as a thief and a robber. But he that entereth in by the door is a shepherd of the sheep. To him the porter is open, and the sheep hear his voice. And he calleth his own sheep by name, and leadeth them out. He's the door. In other words, he goes through the door. A thief will climb through a window. But the person that owns it, you know, they've got a key to the door. The word gives us the key to the door. Now, if a police officer were to come by and they see you crawling in the window, you'd be going through the door, you would think. The only way is through Jesus. He is the door. The sheep need the shepherd because sheep get lost. They're defenseless. They're dirty. And he's the shepherd. We need a shepherd today. Our lives have to have purpose. And to a shepherd, sheep have purpose. Where are we today? Are we his sheep? Is he our shepherd? If we don't know where we want to go, how do we know how to get there? If I know today I want to be his sheep, God's word tells us how to become his sheep. What do we want today? We just want to be able to go to church and go home. Do we want to be his sheep? Do we want to be everything that the shepherd wants us to be? We got to come to the shepherd. In other words, my sheep hear my voice, and he says, and they follow me. If the Lord calls you today and you want to be his sheep, we follow his voice. We follow his voice. He said also about his sheep, he said there's others. They're not part of the sheep. He said, other sheep I have which are not of this fold. They also must I bring, and they shall hear my voice. And there shall be one fold and one shepherd. If you're here today and he's not your shepherd, he wants you to be one of his sheep. Let us pray. Dear Lord, we're so thankful for your word. We're so thankful for all the things you provide for us as a shepherd. And I pray, Lord, as your voice speaks to us today, maybe we've strayed away that we hear your voice and we come running. Maybe today we realize we're not part of the sheep, your fold. Today you give the invitation to enlarge his flock. I pray, Lord, that we come today if we hear your voice. In Jesus' name we pray and ask. Amen.